Holy Week, an important time in the Christian calendar, some would say the most important time. The observances that Christians around the world will keep this week move us behind the joyful celebrations of last Sunday, Palm Sunday, and take us through a dark week to the celebration of Easter Sunday. But this week the focus is on suffering and humiliation, the death of Jesus, which were the central events of Holy Week. Our hope of the resurrection and the promise of new life are created against the background of death and endings. The week following Palm Sunday is Holy Week, and some churches have services every day this week. Between the palm leaves last Sunday and the Easter lilies next Sunday, there is a cross and a crown of thorns. You can't have a resurrection celebration next Sunday morning unless you have a very real death on Friday. New beginnings come from endings. Holy Week service can guide you to reflect upon your life's losses and the grace of new beginnings that God might make possible for you. Holy Week services can become a powerful proclamation of the transformative power of the gospel of Jesus Christ. We can see that God is at work in the lives of people, even in the days of their suffering, pain, and loss, especially when we are hurting. It is important for us to know that God understands and to know that God stays close to us during our most painful times. Today we're reflecting upon the pain and suffering of Jesus and how it can comfort us in our pain. Jesus understands when we are hurting and suffering, grieving and dying. Jesus has been there too. The painful experience of Jesus during that Holy Week has been captured in a powerful essay in a book by Max Lucado. The book is no wonder they call him the Savior. And in the chapter entitled "The Fog of the Broken Heart," Max Lucado has captured the spirit of Jesus' suffering during that Holy Week. The fog of the broken heart. These are the words of Max Lucado. The fog of the broken heart, it's a dark fog that slyly imprisons the soul and refuses easy escape. It's a silent mist that eclipses the sun and beckons the darkness. It's a heavy cloud that honors no hour and respects no person. Depression, discouragement, disappointment, doubt, all are companions of this dreaded presence. The fog of the broken heart disorients our life. It makes it hard to see the road. Dim your lights, wipe off the windshield, slow down, do what you wish. Nothing helps. When this fog encircles us, our vision is blocked, and tomorrow is forever away. When this billowy blackness envelops us, the most earnest words of help and hope are vacant phrases. If you've ever been betrayed by a friend, you know what I mean. If you've ever been dumped by a boy or girlfriend or abandoned by a parent, you have seen this fog. If you have ever placed a spade of dirt on a loved one's casket or kept vigil at a dear one's bedside, you too recognize this cloud. If you have been in this fog, or if you are in it now, you can be sure of one thing. You are not alone. Even the saltiest of sea captains have lost their bearings because of the appearance of this unwanted cloud. Like the comedian said, if broken hearts were commercials, we'd all be on TV. Think back over the last 2 or 3 months. How many broken hearts did you encounter? How many wounded spirits did you witness? How many stories of tragedy did you read about or experience yourself? The suffering of the broken heart. Go with me for a moment to witness what was perhaps the foggiest night in history. The scene is very simple. You'll recognize it quickly. A grove of twisted olive trees, ground cluttered with large rocks, a low stone fence, a dark, dark night. Now look into the picture. Look closely through the shadowy foliage. You see that person? See that solitary figure? What's he doing? Flat on the ground, face stained with dirt and tears, fist pounding the hard earth, eyes wide with the stupor of fear, hair matted with salty sweat. Is that blood on his forehead? That's Jesus. Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane. Maybe you've seen that classic portrait of Christ in the garden, kneeling beside a big rock, perfectly flowing robe, hands peacefully folded in prayer, a look of serenity on his face, halo over his head, a spotlight from heaven illuminating his golden brown hair. Now, I'm no artist, Max Lucado continues, but I can tell you one thing. The man who painted that picture didn't use the Gospel of Mark as a pattern. Look what Mark wrote about that painful night. When they reached a place called Gethsemane, he said to his disciples, "Sit here while I pray." And he took Peter and James and John with him. Horror and dismay came over him, and he said to them, "My heart is ready to break with grief. Stop here and stay awake." Then he went forward a little, threw himself on the ground, and prayed that if it were possible, the hour might pass him by. "Abba, Father," he said, "all things are possible to you. Take this cup away from me, yet not what I want, but what you want." He came back and found them asleep, and he said to Peter, "Asleep, Simon? Were you not able to keep awake for 1 hour? Stay awake, all of you, and pray that you may be spared the test. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak." Once more he went away and prayed, and on his return he found them asleep again, for their eyes were heavy, and they did not know how to answer him. The third time he came and said to them, "Still sleeping? Still taking your ease? Enough, the hour has come. The Son of Man is betrayed to sinful men. Up, let us go forward. My betrayer is upon us." Listen to those phrases. Horror and dismay came over him. "My heart is ready to break with grief." He went a little forward and threw himself on the ground. Does this look like the picture of a saintly Jesus resting in the palm of God? Hardly. We see an agonizing, straining, and struggling Jesus. We see a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief. We see a man struggling with fear, wrestling with commitments, and yearning for belief. We see Jesus in the fog of a broken heart. My, what a portrait. Jesus is in pain. Jesus is on the stage of fear. Jesus is cloaked not in sainthood, but in humanity. Next time the fog finds you, you might do well to remember Jesus in the garden. The next time you think no one understands, reread the 14th chapter of Mark. The next time your self-pity convinces you that no one cares, pay a visit to Gethsemane. And the next time you wonder if God really perceives the pain that prevails on this dusty planet, listen to him pleading among the twisted trees. Here's my point, Lucado concluded. Seeing God like this does wonders for our own suffering. God was never more human than at this hour. God was never nearer to us than when he hurt. The incarnation was never so fulfilled as in the garden. As a result, time spent in the fog of pain could be God's greatest gift. It could be the hour that we finally see our Maker. If it is true that in suffering God is most like us, maybe in our suffering we can see God like never before. The next time you are called to suffer, pay attention. It may be the closest you'll ever get to God. Watch closely. It could very well be that the hand that extends itself to lead you out of the fog is a pierced hand. Jesus felt so utterly alone, abandoned by his closest friends, totally sold out, and then killed. He wasn't really alone. God was with him the whole time, but he couldn't always feel it. The pain was too great. The fear was so real he could taste it. The anxiety broke out in his forehead in a cold, bloody sweat. The certain conclusion that he was abandoned. The feeling of finding yourself totally alone without a friend in this world. It was all just too much. Have you ever felt those emotions? Jesus knows your pain. Jesus agonized in Gethsemane over what was facing him in the hours ahead. And then Jesus suffered such painful torture and the horrible death on the cross. There are all kinds of artist depictions of Jesus' death because it is the central event of the good news of the gospel. The family and friends of Jesus also suffered the terrible loss of this one they loved so much. Rembrandt has captured the moment of the descent from the cross, where the friends and loved ones and family of Jesus tenderly handle his body to the grave. In Karachi, the lamentation of Christ as his family grieved his departure. Adam and I were asked to speak today during Holy Week because of our own family experience of suffering, pain, and loss. My wife Vicki and I had three sons, Aaron, Andrew, and Adam. Adam is here today. He's the one in the middle there. I think he still plays with his toes sometimes. We've had lots of family experiences together. Aaron was our oldest. He always was the panning for the camera. And the next slide, Sean, there's Vicki and Aaron, Andrew, our middle one, and Adam, who's here today, a little older, a lot wiser. And back 20 years ago, taken this week, 20 years ago, next to Stokely, when the azaleas were in bloom, I think this was Easter Sunday, Adam, the bowl cut was the real rage 20 years ago. There's Aaron, Andrew, and Adam. Mom took that picture. She always had an eye for the boys in front of the azaleas. Aaron was the oldest brother, a computer science major here at Carson-Newman. All three boys chose Carson-Newman of their own volition. We had lots of fun. This is my gangsta days with Aaron and a cousin, Nathan. And Aaron was always in the middle of the action. If there was something to do active, he was a part of it. And this is when alumni was still a men's dorm. This is Third South. There's Aaron. I told you he was in the middle of the action. And some of you are members of the David McNeely fan club. There he is back in the day. He and Aaron were classmates. And then came the summer of 1999. Aaron had just celebrated his 20th birthday that spring, just 3 weeks away from beginning his junior year at Carson-Newman. This is the picture at the beach in 1999. The cottage was owned by the Eagle family. I just always thought that was a cool photograph, that Aaron, the Carson-Newman Eagle. And there's his parking sticker in the corner of the windshield. It's the last picture we made of him, because it was not to be. Late on the night of July 22, he took a very sharp exit ramp much too fast. He dearly loved that red Chevy Blazer, but he was going too fast. And he rolled it over one time. He was ejected onto the ground, but not before he received a sharp blow to the back of his head. We think it must have been a scuba diving air tank that he'd used at the beach from the back seat of the truck. Aaron received what we call a closed head injury. No scratches, cuts, or broken bones. He looked normal, though unconscious. But the brain began to swell inside his skull. The doctors tried everything to stop the swelling. For 8 days, he was a patient in the neurological intensive care unit at Duke University Medical Center. And then he was declared brain dead. We buried the body in a family cemetery in North Carolina, and we drove back to Jefferson City and had a memorial service right here in this very room. We were like the family and friends of Jesus who had to bury his body that Friday evening so long ago. Here's William Blake's woodcut, The Entombment. For our family and for so many friends, Aaron's death plunged us deeply into the fog of a broken heart. A few years after Aaron died, my wife and I went to see the film, The Passion of the Christ. It's a few years old now, and some of you may not know that movie by Mel Gibson. I call it The Gospel According to Mel. But when The Passion of the Christ was over, Vicky spoke first. The crowd was filing out of the theater slowly and silently. Some people were weeping softly. Vicky leaned over to me and she whispered, "Did you think about Aaron?" The film very powerfully depicts Mary, the mother of Jesus, and the loss of her son. And Vicky was identifying strongly with Mary's fog of the broken heart. We're here today in part to testify to the support we receive from church and family and friends. We were never alone. That summer, I was actually doing archaeology work in the Middle East, out on the edge of the desert in Jordan. Dr. Ross Brummett was the friend who got in touch with me with the news of Aaron's accident. On the plane flight home from the Middle East to get to his bedside at Duke Hospital, I was by myself on the plane, but I was never alone. I thought of people I knew would be praying me home, and I remembered people who had recently lost a child or a spouse and who had made it through. Our family was never alone. We were surrounded by people who loved us. People brought food to our home so we didn't have to cook for ourselves in the midst of our grief. I'll never forget Marty Toomey and Barry Wilson, the first through the door with the coffee maker and 3,000 styrofoam cups and Barry's homemade cinnamon buns. Leanne Brummett spent that week of Aaron's hospitalization on the telephone. This was before texting, relaying accurate information from Duke back to everyone in Jefferson City who held us in their prayers. And so in this very sanctuary, we gathered for Aaron's memorial service. We found the place full when we walked in, standing room only. I can tell you specific people and where they sat that day. who was here in the balcony, who was here at the front and was the first to rush forward and hug me when the service was over. Members of the archaeology team home from Jordan sat back there. Robert Parham back there. The West Hamlin Volunteer Fire Department, where Aaron was a firefighter, had a special section over here and sat together. Standing here today, 17 and a half years later, I can remember feeling the fog of the broken heart.
I also remember this sanctuary as a 15-year-old in a fog. If any of you have siblings or cousins or neighbors or friends that act like siblings, it's not always in the most pleasant of circumstances, your relationship. Things are said and done, and especially as the youngest of three boys, and he was 20 and I was 15, I was busy picking fights and trying to make my way. We were in the middle of one when he left the beach. I remember standing in this sanctuary, hugging the wall, which I couldn't because it was lined with people. Standing right over there, talking to my teenage friends who were members of this church and in the youth group with me. We talked about my new haircut. Thank goodness. Because we didn't know what else to talk about. But they were there. And they stood. They were present. And they stayed here until I joined my family in the front pews right here. Death is a very dramatic experience of pain and loss. And it's often the first example we think of. But it's not the only one. There's many forms of pain and separation. One of my first jobs after seminary was working as the pastoral counselor at Skyland Trail. And the program there has helped hundreds of clients, young adults with severe mental illness, between the ages of 18 and 30. It helps incorporate spiritual exploration and growth into their recovery from mental illness in a psychiatric program. Often the clients there have past experiences that make it extremely difficult to approach the ideas of faith or spirituality. Growing up in the Christian South with a mental illness, with well-meaning people trying to help, they get a lot of theological feedback. They get a lot of suggestions. The pastoral counseling program offers these people a non-threatening means by which to connect with God or with spiritual practices. I want to share one example of a client recovering from mental illness, surrounded by God's presence in her pain and her suffering. Her name's Claire. I've changed her name and gotten her permission for this today. And Skyland Trail become a safe place for her to ask really hard questions. Questions that others may have been uncomfortable with. Many of these questions have no good answer, and yet she still has an opportunity to ask them. Claire's a single woman in her early 30s who was forced to take a leave of absence from her position as an oncology nurse, helping people with cancer, to manage her symptoms resulting from dissociative identity disorder, formerly known as multiple personalities. She also has major depression. She struggles with self-injury and thoughts of suicide. She's attempted twice before. Her experience of repeated, severe verbal, physical, and sexual abuse as a child makes it difficult for her to form close, trusting relationships and to stay present in the moment. The pastoral counseling program has provided Claire with space to ask the questions of why me? And why would God let suffering happen at all? In the past, she's viewed asking these questions as off-limits or against the rules. If there's not a good answer, she's not allowed to ask the question in many of her contexts. But she's begun to build trusting relationships through the program and reconnected to God in an authentic way. The authenticity has provided her with hope for her future. When I shared with Claire I'd be speaking, she wrote down a few comments. And this is what she had to say. Skyland Trail has become a safe place for me to ask the really hard questions. I know that many of these questions don't have answers, and yet I'm still allowed to ask them. It's rare to find people in places that are open to the super difficult questions, but this place has been willing to do this, respecting and honoring all that I bring to the table. This program is helping me to get back to exploring old beliefs and traditions that I lost along the journey. This program helps and is willing to walk alongside to be a witness and a sounding board for me. For my personal journey, spirituality was something that got me through some horrific things, and yet somehow I lost it. But this place is giving me an opportunity to find it again. But the single most important piece at this time is that you hold on to hope for me when I'm unable to hold on to it for myself. Sometimes the journey feels like it's too much and things seem too dark, and yet in those places I know that you are willing to hold on to the hope until I'm able to take it back from you again. It may sound small, but for me it is a gift that has helped me to keep on even when it's hard. My current work is as a hospice chaplain. Many of you know what hospice is, and if someone has a terminal diagnosis that is unable to be cured, oftentimes they call in a hospice team, nurse, social worker, chaplain, home health aide. The goal is to keep patients in their most comfortable environment at home, in their nursing facility, not having to yo-yo back and forth to the hospital. We aggressively treat folks for their pain from a medical standpoint, and we work hard to give them opportunities to have quality life and to have the best moments possible, especially with their loved ones, as their days grow short. Sam, again, I've changed his name for this, is a 52-year-old who was enjoying his early retirement. He was tournament fishing and loving his wife of 8 years. He's a recovering alcoholic who had gotten sober 5 years ago. He had made amends with his parents, with his siblings, with his children, with his ex-wife. And his wife, who had moved out amidst his alcoholism, had moved back in many years ago. And they'd gotten their life straight. He'd worked with Celebrate Recovery, which some of you may know, that uses lines very similar to what Chad's opening comments were. In November of 2016, Sam's back was hurting while he was fishing one day. So we went to the doctor. Stage 4 cancer in his spine. 2 surgeries later, in the next 2 weeks, he was unable to walk, but hoping to rehab. He's lost 40 pounds in the last 3 months. His life that he worked so hard to build is fading. His wife, who's in her late 40s, who's been by his side throughout, faces the prospect of the rest of her life without her husband. I sat with Sam and his wife yesterday, about this time, with the hospice nurse, as Sam went in and out of delusional thoughts, of talking about past deceased loved ones that he was seeing as he's transitioning into his final stages of life. But he had moments of lucidity. And in those times, the nurse and I tried to talk honestly with Sam about his disease progression. And that it was time to call anybody that he wanted to call to come and be with him in his final days. And what would very likely be their final goodbyes. We sat, we talked about some medical terms and some medications. I gave him the Blue Book, which is written by a nurse in 86 about the end of life. But mostly, we cried. and we prayed for peace amidst the grief. And when Sam asked me, why can't I walk, Adam? Why can't I live? Why can't I fish again? His good questions did not have good answers. It was awful. And God was there.
The fog of a broken heart. Finding our way out of the fog can be such a lonely road. It's certainly a scary journey, and it can be very, very hard. It's vitally important that we know that someone understands, that we're not alone, that someone has been through it too, someone we can trust, someone will care for us enough to walk beside us through it all. Someone that we know is watching over us. That someone is Jesus.
What wondrous love is this that caused the Lord of bliss to bear the dreadful curse for my soul, for my soul? To bear the dreadful curse for my soul. To God and to the Lamb I will sing, I will sing. To God and to the Lamb I will sing. To God and to the Lamb, who is the great I am? To God and to the Lamb I will sing, I will sing. To God and to the Lamb I will sing. And when from death I'm free, I'll sing on, I'll sing on. And when from death I'm free, I'll sing on. And when from death I'm free, I'll sing and joyful be. And through eternity, I'll sing on, I'll sing on. And through eternity, I'll sing on.
Following the death of my experience of grief and the death of my brother when I was 15, I found myself in the fog. I muted my personality, I shut down, I settled into a pattern of routine during my sophomore year of high school. My hurt draped over me and my pain choked out my relationships. I allowed my suffering to isolate me. I found myself one full year later on a passport youth trip to Florida, standing on a sandy beach overlooking the Atlantic Ocean. I'd stood on a similar beach as I spoke my final words to Aaron before he left. I wandered down the beach away from the youth group one year later, looking into the distance, looking for my brother who was gone. A year's worth of numbness gave way to an intense experience of grief. I fell to my hands and knees as I sobbed, my tears falling into the sand as I mourned the death of my big brother. I stayed there, clenching the sand in my fist as I cried out to Aaron, to God in my pain. And after a while, I'm not quite sure how long, grief does that to time. I felt the gentle hand of a friend on my shoulder, there to lift me up and walk beside me on a journey out of the darkness. The fog comes to us in many ways. It comes to us in times that we're not ready. We never want it. Thomas Merton says, sooner or later we all get the treatment. At many points in my life, I've thought I knew what he meant, and then I think it's something else later. But it comes to me in this moment. For those of you that are experiencing the fog of a broken heart, who are experiencing grief in this moment, or have done what we do, which is put it away until we can take it back out to deal with it at a later time, I invite you to engage those people around you, to do your best not to isolate yourself in your grief. Some things you can do when life is painful and heavy. Acknowledge your loss. Give yourself the time and the space to grieve uniquely. Grief is a universal experience that is uniquely interpreted. Another thing you can do is stay in community. Do not isolate yourself as much as you may want to. And also take care of yourself. Do the small things for you that you don't feel like doing, that you know will be good for you.
The Bible describes a God who never abandons us, no matter what we've done or no matter what we are facing. Holy Week tells us the very important truth about ourselves, that Jesus went through what we go through, including the pain, the suffering, the grief, and the death. Jesus knows the fog of my broken heart and yours. Jesus knows my pain. Listen to the words of the writer of Hebrews in the New Testament as he describes that truth. Since God's children are made of flesh and blood, it's logical that the Savior took on flesh and blood in order to rescue them by his death. By embracing death, taking it into himself, he destroyed the devil's hold on death and freed all who cower through life, scared to death of death. It's obvious, of course, that he didn't go to all this trouble for angels. It was for people like us, children of Abraham. That's why he had to enter into every detail of human life. Then, when he came before God as high priest to get rid of the people's sins, he would have already experienced it all himself, all the pain, all the testing, and would be able to help where help was needed.
As we stumble through the fog of our broken hearts, Jesus walks with us. God sends others alongside us in our times of pain. In our humanity, especially in our brokenness, we are precious to God.